Hey everyone, Mr. Happy here, and welcome to my guide to Dunscaith, the new 24-man raid in patch 3.5. In order to enter, you'll have to complete the Weeping City of Mach and accept the new quest in the Sea of Clouds. It requires a minimum item level of 235 to enter, and rewards item level 260 armor, crafting materials, minions, and triple triad cards. Keep in mind you can only win one piece of armor per week in this raid. You'll also be given one Machi Matter and one Machi Shilling per week from defeating the final boss. The matter can be traded for grade 5 materia, and the shilling can be traded alongside a Machi Penny and a Machi Farthing for a Shire upgrade piece. This raid is broken up into 4 bosses as well as some trash in between. To skip to a specific boss, please use the annotations in the top left hand of the video. The incident starts right away with the first boss, Death Gaze Hollow. Don't run out onto the middle of the airship or you're gonna aggro him as soon as he spawns. Death Gaze is a parody of instant kill mechanics you'll be trying to avoid, most of them geared at knocking you off the sides of the ship. Luckily, you can raise players after they are knocked off. Throughout the fight, Death Gaze will gradually summon giant void squares on the ship's surface. When he casts Void Death 4, these panels instantly kill anyone standing on them. Eventually, the entire arena is covered with them, and the next Void Death 4 cast is going to be an instant wipe, so you'll want to beat him before then. The first mechanic you'll see is Void Death, just a normal one. A giant AoE in the middle of the arena. It will pull you a fixed distance towards it twice, after which it will explode and instantly kill anyone inside. Just never stop running away from it until the cast is finished and you should be okay. Void Arrow 3 places a giant wind AoE in the middle of the arena, which after a brief delay will knock everyone away from its location. Just position yourself along the east or west side so you don't get thrown off. Keep in mind if you're standing on the AoE when it explodes, it will instantly kill you, so avoid touching the swirling edges of the AoE. Eventually, Death Gaze groups an attack called Bolt of Darkness alongside this knockback, which will inflict a damage over time on anyone hit by it. Ideally, you want to get knocked to the side of the ship Death Gaze isn't casting Bolt of Darkness on, but honestly, it's okay to get hit by that if you absolutely have to, just don't get knocked off. The final instant kill mechanic you can avoid is the combination attack of Void Blizzard 4 and Void Arrow 4. When Death Gaze casts Void Blizzard 4, two ice pillars will hit the ship, dealing damage based on proximity when they appear. Death Gaze will then attempt to knock players off the ship with a Void Arrow 4. You just need to make sure that Void Arrow 4 pushes you into one of the Void Blizzard pillars to prevent the instant kill mechanic. Later on in the fight, he will only use a single Void Blizzard 4, so you'll have less room for error here. The rest of Death Gaze mechanics are all minor in comparison. He will cast Doom on 2 party members per alliance, which will only kill you if a healer doesn't Asuna or cleanse it off you. Void Arrow 2 will mark a bunch of players with AoEs that leave behind Tornado, so try to drop these away from the group. Void Blizzard 3 shoots out a bunch of Conal AoEs outwards that can easily be stood between. And finally, he summons 2 Void Sprites, which you should just kill off quickly. They do easy to dodge Conal attacks, so just take care of them and get back to killing Death Gaze. Once Death Gaze is dealt with, you'll come to 2 trash packs made up of Void Crystals. The first one is just 3 crystals. You can probably kill them off before they finish casting. If you don't, they'll just summon some adds for you to deal with. The second set of trash is 4 crystals and 2 unblinking eyes. Kill as many crystals as you can before they finish casting Void Call, and watch out for the gaze attacks that come from the unblinking eyes. Those will petrify you. Once the crystals finish casting, a bunch of void creatures come out. Focus down the Parthenopes first, and there's going to be as many Parthenopes as crystals alive when they finish casting Void Call, before killing off the rest of the adds and moving on to the second boss. The second boss is Ferdiad Hollow, and is arguably the easiest boss of the instance. Before the fight starts, assign 2 raid members to be responsible for the flipping mechanic, which we'll explain in a bit. Ferdiad himself has a few basic mechanics he uses throughout the fight. He has a Conal cast in front of him, he's got a tank buster called Jungler's X, which you should pop a cooldown for, split damage AoEs, and he marks players before throwing spinning weapons at him, just like when you fought him in Amdapur City Hard Mode. Don't touch these spinning weapons, because they will deal quite some damage and knock you back. There really are 2 major mechanics you need to know for this fight. The first one is when Ferdiad summons 4 Atomos minions, 2 red and 2 blue. He's then going to fire either an ice orb or a fire orb into it called the wormhole attack. Depending on what color Atomos he fires the orb into, the same color Atomos will spit it out on the other end. So if he shoots an orb into a red Atomos, the other red Atomos will spit the orb out, where the mechanic will actually happen. There's also 2 different colored orbs with 2 different effects. If he shoots a blue orb at an Atomos, it means get away from the other Atomos of the same color because it's going to do a large point blank AoE. If he shoots a red orb at an Atamos, it means go stand near the other Atamos of the same color, because this one's a donut AoE. Later on in the fight, he'll begin shooting two orbs into both of the different colored Atamos, so just pay attention to which orb goes where and react accordingly. Quick example, if he shoots a red orb at a red Atamos, go stand near the other red Atamos he's not aiming for. If it was a blue orb in this example, you'd stand away from the red Atamos. The other major mechanic I see wipe groups more than anything is Debilitator. Verdiad will mark everyone in the raid group with either fire or water resistance down before summoning 16 puddles around the arena. Each puddle either shows as a water puddle or a fire puddle. By stepping on a puddle, it flips its element. Your goal is to have the majority of the puddles flip to the opposite element of the debuff the raid group has. For example, if everyone has the water debuff, you want all the puddles to be flipped to their fire sides. It is super easy for people to mess with this mechanic just by repeatedly stepping on puddles, not knowing what to do, or trying to fix somebody else's mistake, which is why I recommend you assign two players to be responsible for flipping all of them. It could be the tanks in Alliance B and C, it could be Alliance C's healers, it could be two random DPS, it doesn't matter. Just don't let people try to flip these puddles aimlessly and cause a wipe. As he approaches half-life, Ferdiad eventually shields himself in the center of the room and summons a bunch of fools alongside the outside of the arena. They shoot AoEs and use gaze attacks that petrify. They also dash around the arena to reposition, sometimes dashing through an Atamos minion to teleport somewhere else. Ferdiad himself even uses a giant cleave that you need to avoid, but it has a really long cast time. Just do your best to kill off all the fools as fast as possible. Ferdiad will deal damage when you kill all of the adds to the entire raid, which increases the longer the adds are alive. The remaining half of the fight is mostly the same mechanics as before, just more of them. Two orbs for the wormhole, like we mentioned before, and expanding ground AoEs you want to avoid are really the only new things you'll see here. Just keep not dying, and Ferdiad's second half will go fast enough. Before the third and fourth boss is only one more trash pack. It's just one succubus mob that summons some adds and shoots lots of AoEs. The giant foobar adds leave behind poison puddles, so kill them off as they spawn and don't step in the bad. Watch out for the tank damage from Bloodsword as well, but after clearing this out, you're moving on to the third and the fourth boss back to back. The third boss is Queen Skothak, and she is notorious for her very fast casting abilities. You'll need to study her attack animations in order to know what AoEs are coming out next. Don't try to wait for the AoE marker on the ground. Look at her. Skothak starts the fight with many of these speedy AoEs too. When she does a tank buster, she'll jump straight up in the air afterwards, and after a brief delay, come back down with a point-blank AoE. When she extends her giant hands from her back, she'll do two conal AoEs, one out of the front right of her hitbox, and one out of the back left of her hitbox, so get to one of the two safe zones to avoid them. An easy way to see this is to stand directly in front or behind of her character model, so you can see the entire wingspan of the giant hands. She'll always follow this up with a large point-blank AoE knockback, so keep that in mind. When Skothak jumps away, she'll use a large AoE around her as well, and a couple of smaller AoEs overlapped. If you get hit by both and you're not a tank, you're probably dead. So when she jumps away from the group uncontrollably, just don't follow her. Just stay away from her. Let her do it on her own. The big mechanic I see kill most people is when the entire arena reads, "Shadows gather on the floor," right on your screen. When you see the entire floor enveloped in a shadowy, cracked animation, stop doing everything. Drop your target, don't move, don't attack, take your hands off the controller or the keyboard, and wait until the shadows are gone. If you get caught attacking or moving during this animation, you'll have your movement speed slowed and you'll start taking a ton of damage over time, which the combined effects of these can make the next mechanic likely kill you. Most of the time, she just does a room-wide AoE called 30 Souls, but sometimes she also drops an add, which deals proximity damage, and if you're slowed and can't move away from it, it's gonna hurt. Speaking of that add, by the way, it's called a Kanla. You'll want to have one of the other tanks pick it up and make sure it doesn't go near the queen. If it does, it tethers to her and starts healing. You'll want to kill the Kanla before it uses Full Swing, which will wipe the group. The next attack you'll likely see is a marker followed by a giant swirly AoE of death. When the AoE disappears, a giant void orb will hit that area, deal damage, and knock anyone hit away. The AoE then proceeds to happen repeatedly, following the player who was marked initially. If you're marked, do your best to kite this away from the raid group. Towards the end of this phase, you'll probably see two shadow hands come out and tether to two separate players. These limbs will charge a tethered player very fast, but will stop dead in their tracks if the marked player is looking directly at them, almost like a boo monster. Just be sure to look at them and kill them before they can cast Unhand. Don't walk into melee range of them either, please. Finally, she has an attack called Shade Thrust, where she'll turn and face a direction and do a giant line AoE in that direction. There's no AoE marker, so you just have to pay attention to where she turns when she casts it. After about 50% of her HP, Scothic will retreat to a protective barrier in the center and summon a legion of adds. Most of them just cast spells or AoEs to dodge or heal through. There is a chimera that spawns that does its usual, you know, rams and dragons voice, which can be silenced or dodged like every other chimera in the game. Keep in mind there are also meteor markers that come down. Make sure one person, doesn't matter who, stands under each meteor to prevent it from exploding on the whole raid. Once all the adds are dead, Scothic will do some raid-wide damage before moving on to her final phase. Her final phase is basically all the same mechanics as phase 1 and the add phase, just more of them and having a lot of them overlapped. She will use two new attacks in that of 30 arrows, which shoots an AoE and then shoots a bunch of AoEs from the impact point of that AoE that you'll just need to not stand in, and also she starts using split damage AoEs throughout the rest of the phase. Otherwise, it's all stuff that you've already seen in the first half of the fight. Finish her off, and now prepare for the true final boss of the raid, Diablos. The first two phases of Diablos are practically meant to let you win, so these will go by pretty quick. In phase 1, Diablos is similar to his fight back in the Lost City of Amdapur. You want to look away from him during his nightmare attack to avoid being slept, kill the Void Doors when they spawn instead of using them, stand under him when he goes to cast Ultimate Terror, and stack up for any split damage AoEs that he uses. You can even stun and pacify him in this first phase to prevent him from casting Ultimate Terror or other abilities. Ruinous Omen he uses in this phase just does some raid-wide damage, it's easily mitigatable. Around 35%, Diablos flees and begins charging his ultimate attack. At the same time, a giant life gate appears, which you must kill repeatedly to end the phase. It takes 4 or 5 kills before the phase ends, and the small void doors will also appear, and you need to kill them to prevent adds from spawning. Once you've pushed back Diablos' attack, he will absorb the corpse of Scothic and enter his final, true phase. Interesting to note, if you wipe after Diablos has become Diablos Hollow, you can actually start from the final phase instead of starting from phase 1. Just goes to show you how RP the first two phases were. The boss's final phase is a mix of the Queen and Diablos' mechanics. He'll start the fight completely immune to damage and with a massively increased critical hit rate. Expect your tank to take a lot of damage here, and awareness helps a lot. He'll alternate between Hollow Kamisado on the main tank, it's a tank buster, and Scothic's Shade Thrust AoE. Eventually, you'll break through a shield and begin to actually damage the boss. Once you can start damaging him, you'll start to see those giant void AoEs plus the markers come out from the Scothic fight, as well as a new split damage marker that also has an eye over it. Basically, you'll want to stack with the marked player, but also make sure you're looking away from them. Meteor markers start popping up as well, but there's a new one in the center of the room that deals heavily increased damage, so make sure that it's a tank taking the middle meteor. After a few of these mechanics, Diablos will summon two Death Gates, which you must kill to prevent adds from spawning. He also summons a Diabolic Gate, which players can actually walk near to enter and fight a Shadow Dragon. I recommend sending an Alliance B to the Diabolic Gate, while Alliances A and C kill the two Death Gates that spawn. Failure to kill a Death Gate summons Void Hounds, and failure to kill the dragon fast enough inside of the Diabolic Gate will allow it to pass through the gate as well and begin fighting the rest of the Alliance. After this, Diablos mostly does mechanics you've seen before, just with the word Hollow in front of them. Hollow Nightmare dooms any players looking at Diablos, but it can be cleansed. Hollow Omen replaces Ruinous Omen, and just appears to do about 15 to 16k raid damage, so stack near the boss and mitigate it. I think it might also deal damage if you're in the center of the room, more damage that is, because I've seen it one-shot people there, and I didn't die when I was standing along the outside in both attempts that I've had. So I just say, stack near the boss, he's kinda along the outside of the room. After Hollow Omen, Diablos uses Double Edge, which causes him to take high damage over time in exchange for him to deal much higher damage to the raid. He'll start spamming attacks on you at this point, like Earthshakers, which if you haven't seen before are line AoEs towards marked players, split damage AoEs, and orbs that float towards random players that you'll want to intercept before they stack up and hit like 3 people at a time with 3 orbs. It's mostly an endurance test to survive the mechanics he is pushing out super fast, so focus on staying alive and dealing damage when you can, and he should fall over eventually. Thank you, Double Edge. And that's going to be a wrap for my guide to Dunscathe. Best of luck in the Duty Finder, just be sure to be patient with first-timers, because there's a lot of mechanics here that there's no way they'll recognize right off the bat. Definitely be sure to explain things, make a macro, do whatever you gotta do, and you should be able to get through this no more difficultly than the Weeping City of Mach. Anyway, again, be sure to like, favorite, subscribe, and share, and stay tuned for my next video for Final Fantasy XIV. Until then, take care.